please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Delhi turns into a gas chamber. The capital becomes a death trap. Expats refuse Delhi postings. Executives avoid capital punishment. Screaming headlines which have grabbed national attention. But this, ladies and gentlemen, is not Delhi's problem alone. Delhi is simply sounding a red-hot alert for all cities of India where air quality is steadily dipping. Cities like Mumbai and Chennai, where air can escape with sea breeze, have also plunged to average or moderate air quality, and others are slowly heading the poor way. And shockingly, there's no solution yet for India's capital city, which is making international headlines as the second worst city to live in. Imagine what will happen when in a few years, alarming bells ring across the country. Welcome everyone to the shocking urban reality of the air we breathe. And is there anything at all which can be done to diffuse this ticking time bomb? Joining me today on the panel, Debi Goenka, Executive Trustee at Conservation Action Trust. Also joining me, Vivek Chattopadhyay, representing Clean Air and Sustainable Mobility at CSC. Manjali Khosla, co-founder Care for Air. And in Bangalore, Sridhar Pabisetti, CEO Nama Bengaluru. Thank you so much for joining me, Manjali Khosla. My first question is to you. This seems to be a complete failure of governance. Delhi has shown that. I believe you've got a monitor. I mean, I've escaped to Mumbai, but I'm just feeling so bad for everybody living in that city. What's going on today?
Well, they keep on saying that the winds are blowing westerly and so it's better. But, you know, if it's not Delhi's problem, the air just goes to another city in India. The World Health Organization in 2014 already told us that 13 of the worst cities, most polluted cities, are in India. I mean, shame on us. It's been since 2014, our government has totally failed. Supreme Court has given out a few rulings, but all the politicians, even recently in the news, they've been blaming each other. But no, as you had said earlier, they've not been able to help their people at all. It's a disaster and people are dying. The World Health Organization already said in 2016, in September 2016, that 92% of the world population is living above the air pollution levels that should not be tolerated. They are hazardous for our health. And guess where most of the people in the world live? In our own country.
Absolutely. Well, it's a
national... So something has to be done.
In not just an international epidemic, it is definitely a national epidemic. I mean, I've got this Lancet Commission report, which is looking at India's state-level disease burden. November 2017 released. It says exposure value of outdoor air pollution has actually increased by 17% from 1990 to 2016. This has caused cardiovascular and respiratory diseases and infections. Now, air pollution is the second leading risk factor in India as a whole. I'm just wondering what's going on. I mean, what happened, Vivek, to that graded response action plan? Each of those things have simply not worked in Delhi. What's CSE's own assessment of what we've got wrong in the capital? Then, of course, we go to the country as a whole.
See, the major issue with the air pollution crisis is that we wake up during the when the levels are very high or in the emergency level. So, and there has been no long-term action plan. And what you can see that every day or every week there is a court order. So the issue is we don't have the long-term clean air action plan in the place. So there is no roadmap that Delhi has drawn to meet the air quality standards during the winter. It reaches to the crisis and the emergency level. So whatever like damage control or whatever you can say, the firefighting situation happens and government comes into play to act on the polluting sources. And that has been the case for the past few
years.
Where is
it acting? Vivek Chattopadhyay, where is it acting? There's nothing been done even for Delhi as of now. I mean, not even has been multiple agencies, political slugfest, but really what decision has been taken?
Yeah.
What action has been taken? None of us in Delhi are breathing any bit of cleaner air than we were when the emergency bells were ringing a week before.
See, once the smog has accumulated, it is very difficult to bring down the smog level. So the action has to be preemptive before the winter. Mm-hmm. And before, not just before the winter, beginning of the year itself. So I think there has been no action taken on the, like, all the actions have been delayed, like diversion of the trucks. The peripheral expressway order was passed a decade ago, but implementation was very tardy. You can say the burning of the garbage that happens because Delhi could not manage its garbage dumps, and they keep burning. There is no action plan on how to manage the solid waste in the city. Okay. Also, the vehicular traffic has reached to 1 crore, the total.
Wow.
So, the government has failed to improve the bus services in the city. So now the city is chock-a-block with the traffic, and you have
and
the garbage issue.
Chock-a-block with pollution. Chock-a-block with pollution.
Automatically.
Okay, nothing's happening. Nothing is happening.
Yes.
Vivek, I get your point. Now let's take a look at each of the contributors of air pollution. What really causes pollution in any of the cities of India? Now, top sources of PM 2.5 emissions. Number one, as Vivek pointed out, more vehicles in Delhi than any other city, but Bangalore is not far behind. Road dust is another large source for North India, particularly fire at landfills. That's another big problem that we face, the capital faces. And, you know, waste segregation is not happening, or waste processing is not happening anywhere in the country. Power plants, which dot all the cities of India. It's not just Delhi alone. Crop burning, of course, is a Delhi situation or a North India situation, but it could soon spread. Shridhar Pabi Shetty, when I talk about vehicular pollution, seems to be in the road dust, which is generated from vehicular pollution, essentially will start affecting Bengaluru as well. Is Bangalore conscious of it at all, of the air quality in that city?
I would say that the Bengalurians are conscious about it, but unfortunately the governance in Bengaluru is not.
Mm-hmm.
Let me prefix this by saying that the biggest challenge has been that environment and ecology has never become a governance priority. And that is the real crux of all the problem. And the real way to solve this is to bring back the ownership of the solutions to be implemented at a ward level, at the leadership of a ward committee and others. The problem is that today we look at some centralized seat of institution to give us a solution for our environmental problems.
Hmm.
But the solution is as much local, and we should understand that. If you look at Bangalore itself, right, I mean, the same contributing sources exist in Bangalore except for the crop burning, right? All other things are happening in Bangalore. You will always find some fire somewhere or the other for some garbage mound happening. And if you look at it, our metro has been much, much delayed. And Manisha, you'll be shocked to realize that even after integrating two lines of metro, we have not added additional coaches.
Hmm.
We are just living by the promise that three more coaches will be added by December. And I really, really hope that we add them, because there is so much demand to travel by metro. Today, we are packed like sardines in the metro, in the metro train.
My God. Hmm.
Unfortunately, public transport has not really taken off. We can always blame and say limit the number of vehicles. But where will people travel? People have to travel. We live in cities to commute, to work, for economies of scale.
Absolutely.
If you say we will limit the number of vehicles without giving alternative transport options, then we are choking. Bangalore has the
choking
best
productivity.
Operated bus transport network.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You were choking
and
mobility.
But unfortunately,
I get that. Let me come to Mr. Devi as well. So big issues that he's raised, right? That for every city, vehicular traffic is increasing and is going to cause more and more pollutants in the air. And public transport is simply not keeping up. Having odd even schemes might be short respite. Of course, that itself can't be implemented in Delhi because of NGT intervention. What do you think as an environmentalist cities of India should be doing?
Well, I think we have to look at the long-term sustainability of our children, our grandparents, and so on. I don't think we can continue like this.
Hmm.
Today, the government is crazy about chasing GDP, and GDP is being just, you know, for the sake of showing growth and progress. We are in a GDP mania. We can't continue like this. We can't keep building new thermal power plants.
Mumbai definitely hasn't gone to poor levels of air pollution as of now.
Not so far this year.
But it's losing its open spaces. And again, I mean, the suburban traffic is increasing. Metro will take some time in terms of getting completed. So there is no alternative. Is the government here even thinking of air?
Not at all. What should be done in Mumbai is quite simple to my mind. Hmm. We have to actually upgrade the suburban train system.
Train and metro?
The metro will, of course, take a long time, but the suburban train system has to be upgraded to keep pace with the growing population. Mm-hmm. That is low-hanging fruit, but the government is not interested because there's more money in the metro. We have a thermal power plant in Chembur, which is running on gas, run by Tata Power. They want to actually convert it to coal, and they're calling it modernization. This is the world we are living in.
This is going to happen?
In Bombay.
They're
500
actually thinking of converting a gas-based
power plant
to coal.
And the Ministry of Environment has permitted it. We have challenged that in court.
My God.
But this is the world we are living in. And our decision makers just don't seem to get it. We can't live on coal. We can't live on coal dust. We have to have clean air. We have to have clean water. But that obviously is not a priority for our decision makers.
My goodness. All right. So this is what's happening in the cities of India. I mean, you're actually looking at converting a gas-based cleaner power plant into a coal-based thermal plant in the center of Mumbai in Chembur. This is shocking. I'm going to just go to another important point before I head into a break. Now, you know, we look at the health cost of air pollution. But when I look at just the World Bank study, this is a 2016 study, 8.5% of India's GDP is lost due to air pollution. So we are saying that, wow, our cities contribute to our GDP. The fact of the matter is that 8.5% will be lost due to air pollution. And if I look at the welfare cost, labor, lost labor income, all of these hurt the economy. India ranks second to China on premature deaths due to air pollution, second only to China. Well, we also rank second only to China when it comes to urbanization, and this problem seems to be getting more and more critical. When we come back, we'll try and go to our other panelists to find out what the solutions are and whether they're implementable at all or not to protect our lungs. Welcome back. Indian cities will generate 70% of net new jobs created by 2030, produce around 70% of India's GDP, and drive a near fourfold increase in per capita income across the nation. India is also going to overtake China when it comes to urbanization. But today on Urban Reality, we're asking at what cost, when our government authorities and policy makers can't get something as basic as the air we breathe to stay clean and healthy. And this is becoming worrying me. The entire growth is becoming worrying. The urbanization is becoming worrying. Manjali, I'm going to come to you and ask you this very basic question. This seems to be a complete political and governance failure. So what can the citizens do? Is there anything at all that citizens can take control of rather than being on Twitter or on WhatsApp and just being armchair activists?
Okay, so we have to inconvenience ourselves. The metro is always chock-a-block. Mm-hmm. We don't have extra carriages in there. Plus, we don't have end-to-end. So even if I was to take a metro with my kids to school, I can't actually get to the school without taking a scooter, which is not electric. So I'm right. Also contributing. In fact, I remember last time when there was odd even, you had to drive your car, and my car is a hybrid, which fortunately I was allowed to drive. But my other friends who had petrol cars had to rent taxis that were diesel.
So that didn't even make sense.
So the things we can do, some of the rules just, it feels like people are just making rules in the government without actually thinking about it. Now, as per urban emissions, 50% of our PM2.5 is solely because of transport and trash burning. Hmm. This is urbanemissions.info, and Dr. Sarath Gurukhande is a leading environmental scientist. So if these are the two things, what we really need to figure out is our transport. Now, nobody here has talked about the quality of diesel that India uses. Other than, I think, 26 cities that are on Bharat 4, the rest of India is in Bharat 3. That is very high sulfur content. So last, there was a public interest litigation at the Supreme Court where they said that we could go, that we would have to have Bharat 6 in 2020. And recently, I believe in the newspapers, it's next year.
Absolutely.
But the thing is,
we've
it's been so long.
It. At
but least people should be
reaction.
Given a choice.
It seems to be a knee-jerk reaction, Vivek Chattopadhyay, well, yeah, government's decision to just, you know, bring forward the Bharat norms. I don't you think it's just a knee-jerk reaction? In fact, now all the auto companies are saying, what's going on? How can we change all our production norms so quickly to meet new environment standards?
Definitely, these decisions, the BS4 came in Delhi and other cities, in mega cities, in 2010. Thereafter, government took a lot of time to take a decision on next stage of the emission standards. And only in 2016, they took the decision that India will meet the next level of emission standards by 2020. And now they have done a good thing that Delhi will have the BS6, but what about other cities? And it's a major issue because vehicular population across the cities, and especially in mega cities, is growing leaps and bounds. So I think the emission standards have to be tightened, but at the same time, we have to look at the on-road vehicles, which are very polluting, and you can spot, and nobody has faith on the on-road emission checks conducted by PUC centers. Those are pollution under control centers. So our on-road vigilance and emission checking system has to improve. We have to weed out the gross polluting vehicles from the roads. And best
well,
way
Vivek
is
Chattopadhyay
to
in Delhi,
our
they actually
centers.
Allowed 60,000 trucks to come in just because one of the orders expired at 11 p.m. at night. This who's going to check vehicles? I mean, what we are the conversation seemed to be
See,
more
the
and
trucks,
more about
trucks.
Go ahead.
The problem is the infrastructure needed to check the vehicles have not been upgraded or not up to the mark across the country. Like, we have conducted an audit of PUC centers in Delhi, and we have found that even in Delhi, few centers were passing the vehicles which were supposed to be filled. But in the NCR cities, the PUC infrastructure is totally like lacking. They are using false or fake softwares. They are passing with corruption. So I think this is the story across cities.
You talked about the PUC system. I read a wonderful article that now by Nandan Nilekani, and I'm going to come to you, Sridhar Pabhi. I mean, you are talking to us from the tech capital, where he says that every vehicle in India can be actually armed with a simple technology-oriented system. I'm forgetting what that exact name is, where you can, they don't have to stop at tolls to pay the toll. There, that is, the technology links every car to a single account. You can check the vehicular emissions from that car. Technology makes it possible, there is absolutely no will even to adopt low-hanging technology solutions when it comes to air pollution.
I completely agree, Manisha. I think what we have to realize is that today in the city of Bengaluru, there are 2.5 lakh cars that are visible on a mobile app through just two private car transport companies. Unfortunately, instead of spending 70 crores, we can't see 6,000 government-run buses on our mobile phones. If only we take the efficiency and new technology and say public transport can be efficient, can also be cost-effective, and if that is internalized by government, they can outcompete the cars and any other private modes of transport any day.
And
the
I interrupted you, Sridhar, but Karnataka state-run transport corporation is actually a sterling example of having a public transport system and also which can also be profitable, isn't it? So it can be replicated across the
country. Absolutely. Absolutely, but they still are missing the goal of outcompeting the private modes of transport. Because today I can't have a guarantee of what time I'll reach office if I were to take a public transport system. The last mile connectivity is very important, because even though I can get into metro and out of metro, and metro ride is fast, but from home or office to metro becomes a problem. And that's where all our public transport system being available and traceable on mobile phones will bring in the huge shift of people onto the public transport system. Mm-hmm. I want to add a second thing answering your previous question of saying that what can be done at a ward level and at a local governance level. It's important for us to know what we have lost in the city of Bengaluru, and this is lessons for across all cities. The concretization of our green spaces, the encroachment of our lakes has completely deteriorated our ability to absorb pollutants. We should understand while reducing the putting of pollutants into the environment is one important aspect. Second is increasing the absorption capacity of carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, etc. is also rapidly diminishing. Mm. So the green cover, the lakes, and all of these are deteriorating at a very, very fast pace
right.
in our race to be on a high GDP curve.
I think, Sridhar, you said it, but let me also curve. Get our gentleman here from Mumbai who's also facing a similar problem. I mean, open green spaces in Mumbai haven't been there for the longest time, sir. What you're getting saved by is the sea breeze, and therefore the air quality here still remains moderate and not poor. Is that something that environmentalists such as you are conscious of?
Absolutely. In fact, we have to keep going to court to protect our open spaces.
Constantly
we have to file a public interest litigation
right?
to protect Sanjay Gandhi National Park. We have to go to court to protect our mangroves. Hmm. We'll have to go to court to protect our salt pans and so on and so forth. The government just does not seem to be interested in protecting the environment. And to come back to the issue of vehicular pollution, I must say the only solution to vehicular pollution is to have good public transport.
You can't keep subsidizing private transport.
You can't subsidize flyovers. You can't subsidize sea links. You have to, in fact, increase the public transportation, make it comfortable, make it usable and user-friendly. That's the only way you're going to solve the vehicular pollution problem.
I think a common thread in this conversation has been public transport. If you do not get your public transportation system right, you cannot even begin to have a conversation around controlling or keeping your air clean or controlling your air pollution. Now, this is something which every city, how is it not possible to get public transportation systems right when you're talking about 100 smart cities? That is the big question. And if all state governments and, of course, the center doesn't wake up to it, I think we are in serious trouble. Debi Goenka, thank you very much for joining me. Vivek Chattopadhyay, always a pleasure to have CSU View. Manjali Khosla, I believe that your advocacy group is making as much noise as possible. Sridhar Pabishetty, thanks so much. Well, it's now a fact that air pollution is soon turning into a national pandemic. If we do not wake up now, no high growth momentum or demographic dividend will be worth it. Thank you so much for joining me. I'll be back with you same time next week.